on this episode of the WildFed podcast.
There's these beautiful gifts out in the woods, and I want to eat that. And they're super scary, too.
Sometimes I find them, they're almost purple. Sometimes they're dusky tans and browns. Sometimes they're gray. I found them where they're almost albino.
Do a conserva where you're putting it in a ton of oil with herbs, and then you add a little bit of acidic vinegar to it. A lot of people pickle mushrooms and then cook with them.
Man, you're making me really hungry. There's these roles for mushrooms to play in the future. Part of it is in medicine. Part of it is in psychology. Part of it is in landscape regeneration.
You can have so much fun knowing 10 mushrooms and being in the woods. I would encourage people to not be overwhelmed and realize that we're all overwhelmed, and that's kind of the fun of it.
Proceed at your own risk and take self-responsibility. There's old mushroom pickers and there's bold mushroom pickers, but there's no old bold mushroom pickers.
You can eat any mushroom once.
Yeah, exactly.
Episode 115 of the WildFed podcast, You Can Eat Any Mushroom Once with Kathy Yerich, is brought to you by SurfThrival. SurfThrival's just released a brand new energy drink mix called Biomatrix. It's a natural, water-soluble, powdered energy drink mix based on an energizing concentrate of yerba mate. With a refreshing iced tea-like flavor and bright citrus notes, it gives you a nice lift without the jitters of many pre-workout formulas. And it supports your natural energy levels with a custom blend of amino acids and adaptogenic herbs like schisandra, goji berry, and rhodiola. If you're looking for a natural energy boost that won't leave you feeling wired, spun out, or depleted, check out Biomatrix at surfthrival.com. While you're there, take a look at the entire product line. As we head into winter, now's a great time to pick up a bottle of SurfThrival's Daylight Concentrate, a vitamin D3 supplement like no other. Learn more at surfthrival.com, where the coupon code WildFed always gets you 5% off your order. SurfThrival, why just survive when you can thrive? This episode of the WildFed podcast is also brought to you by Wild Food Warehouse. Are you looking for authentic, hand-harvested wild rice? Not that overpriced, patty-grown stuff you see in the supermarket, but the naturally occurring, truly wild rice that's forager-harvested under Minnesota's strict ricing laws. Wild Food Warehouse delivers hand-foraged, wood-fire-parched wild rice direct to your door. You can even use the coupon code WILDFED to get an additional 10% off your order. Wild rice is more than just a healthy, gluten-free grain. It's a sacred food that was and is a staple for the indigenous peoples of the Great Lakes region, where it's still hand-harvested from canoes today. Some of that rice makes it to market, and now you can get your own. Truly Wild Rice cooks up soft with a gentle, nutty flavor that's prized by chefs, epicureans, and of course, wild food enthusiasts too. Go to wildfoodwarehouse.com and use the coupon code WILDFED to get Truly Wild Rice delivered direct to your door. I'm Daniel Vitalis, and you're listening to the WildFed Podcast, a show about reconnecting with nature through hunting, fishing, foraging, and food. WildFed, food is all around you. You can eat any mushroom once. It's a common joke amongst mushroom foragers and mycologists, and while it's meant to be funny, it speaks to a couple of themes we explore often here on the show. The first, of course, is how few of the local species around us that most of us know, despite sharing an environment with them, something we are always trying to remedy here at WildFed. The second is how much interest there is today in eating wild mushrooms. It's like after centuries of mycophobia, our society has just emerged from the fungal dark ages with an appetite for shelves and toadstools. People see a mushroom, and if they think you might even have the faintest idea of what it is, the first thing they ask is, can I eat that? So it's in the spirit of that very question that I'm speaking with Kathy Yerich today. She's the co-author of Mushrooms of the Upper Midwest, a field guide for lay folks in that area to use identifying fungi around them. She's been part of the Minnesota Mycological Society for 15 years and the North American Mycological Association for about 12 years. She's also very enthusiastic, like so many of you, about wild foods, and mushrooms for her are more than an academic interest. They're a food source. I really hope this encourages you to set some mushroom foraging goals for the coming year, unless you're lucky enough to live in a place where mycelia fruit this time of year, in which case, get out there. Me, I'm feeling committed to putting more time into mushrooming this coming season. But until then, I'll do some winter chaga hunting and keep making chaga tea until the snows melt away, the weather warms up, and new flushes of mushrooms start pushing their way up through the forest floor again. Kathy Yerich, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much. I'm really honored to be invited.
I'm sitting here looking at the book you're a co-author of, Mushrooms of the Upper Midwest. This is the second edition. And I'd love to hear a little bit about you and about this book.
Yeah, well, so gosh, maybe 15 years ago, I bought my grandma's old farmhouse. And for years, there was a big chicken of the woods, or turns out to be it was a chicken of the woods, that was growing on this oak tree in the front of her yard. And I wanted to try it so bad. I remember she would laugh and say, people drive by and have asked for that for years.
No way.
My aunt said, yeah. My aunt's like, oh, it was huge. It was huge. People would drive by and say, can we have that? And my aunt said, oh, I remember that growing there in the 40s when I was a kid. Wow. And our family would kind of laugh and go, well, I hear it's a delicacy. And we would just kind of chuckle at, well, there goes some crazy person who's going to eat that. And here I am living at her house, what, like 60 years later. And I'm like, I want to eat that. And I'm scared to death to eat that. I'm like,
The same mushroom was growing for 60 years?
I mean, the same, right? Because chicken of the woods is a parasite. So basically had infected this tree, which was probably a 200-year-old oak.
Wow.
So the fruit, right? So it's like the fruit of the mushroom would grow every year that the conditions were right. And even after that tree was cut down, and it ended up being this crazy hollow tree that, you know, they were really afraid it was going to fall on the house, that mushroom grew on the stump for probably another 6-8 years before the stump was gone.
Until it just exhausted everything it could eat, right?
Exactly. So, yeah, it's one of those things where I think a lot of people get into mushrooms because they want to eat something. Mm-hmm. And there's, you know, just these beautiful gifts out in the woods. And they're super scary, too.
This one you're talking about, the chicken of the woods, if I could just like hang on to the story for a second.
Yeah.
It's such a good inroad. You know, those tree polypores, you know, being non-toxic mushrooms and many really choice edibles. And that one being so distinctive, I think you always see people say sort of look out for, you know, what's the poisonous look-alike, the jack-o'-lantern or something.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, not you know, they don't look that much alike. So it's pretty easy to figure out, okay, I'm looking at chicken of the woods here. And it's so bright orange and so easy to spot. And it's such a huge yield. Did you ever end up eating that mushroom?
I did. Yeah. In fact, when you're talking about poisonous lookalikes, there's really not a lot of poisonous lookalikes. When we talk about the jack-o'-lantern, I feel like if you had them each in your hand, like once you start to learn them, they don't look anything alike, but you're looking in a book and you're looking, you know, now online, there's all these digital sources. There's still just this little bit of, I mean, I'm telling you, I was 99% sure, but I still was like, okay, here we go. We're eating it. And my husband is typically a bit squeamish. I remember a friend of mine and I were like, okay, we're doing it. And we tore it up and it was just like this chicken meat. I remember we did a cream sauce with pasta and some, you know, summer vegetables. And I remember my husband eating and he's like, okay, well, so there's chicken in here, there's pasta, there's some vegetables, and somewhere you snuck a mushroom in that I'm supposed to eat. And I was like, dude, there's no chicken. That is the mushroom. Like he truly thought he was eating chicken meat.
Yeah.
So yeah, you know, like it was life-changing.
That's another one, too, where you could maybe, you know, to pull 25 pounds of mushroom off of a tree is not unrealistic when you get a big one. And I mean, I've sat there eating off of those, you know, a chicken in the woods sometimes lasts me, you know, 12 days, 15 days, because there's just so much food sometimes. You know, I mean, obviously, sometimes you find a small one as well. But one of the things I've noticed is, you know, amongst is your husband a hunter?
He is not.
I saw a potter. Oh, I saw a video of you and you were saying some hunting friends maybe.
Oh, you know, I come from a hunting and fishing family. Like we grew up just fishing. My brother worked for a company that did like the hunting and fishing libraries. So I have a total hunting family. My niece is a bow hunter and ice fisher woman, and just, yeah. So I'm the oddball of the family that I don't know how to shoot a gun and kill things. I only hunt mushrooms mostly.
Well, so that's one of the things that I find really interesting is I've noticed when I'm around hunters who are just sort of like pure hunters, they're always asking me about mushrooms. They're never really, they don't seem so as interested as a group. I'm generalizing here, but I don't see as much interest in green leafy plants. I don't see as much interest in herbal medicine or as in fruits and berries and nuts and seeds. But mushrooms, for some reason, hunters are like, yeah, I want to learn about mushrooms. And I think it's that like meaty quality. You know, you were talking about your husband not realizing this wasn't chicken. And it just seems like hunters are always like, hey, and maybe because they're in the woods in the fall, you know, and they're seeing a lot of mushrooms all the time. But have you noticed that sort of overlap?
Completely. In fact, so my brother is just this great finder of mushrooms. He turkey hunts every spring here in the Midwest. And he has such good luck finding morels, like more so than people who go out hunting for morels. And I suppose you're in the woods for such a long time and you really kind of, you know, get your eyes on, you've really tuned your eyes into your surroundings.
A lot of hunters, and I kind of fall into this category myself, is like, I have a suite of mushrooms that I know really well. I trust my knowledge in them, you know, but like, I'm not part of, you know, like a mycological society. So I don't get that kind of constant reinforcement and also that taxonomy piece. So I wanted to check in with you because you are involved in some mycological societies and I'd like to hear about that. And I'm curious for kind of like how you guys start new people into this, because I don't think I took like the most efficient pathway to learning, sort of like one at a time. But I'd love to hear like when new people come through, like how you work with them.
Yeah, you know, we do a lot of Mushrooms 101. Actually, I'm going to back up a tiny bit. I'm a part of the Minnesota Mycological Society, which is one of the oldest societies in the country. It was started in 1899.
Wow.
And it was started by a female doctor in the Twin Cities who was really interested in making sure people had access to healthy food. So it's a lot of the stuff we're talking about now, even like, you know, food security and where does your food come from? So here she was treating people and saying, you know, a lot of these people I'm treating are sick because they're not healthy, because they're not eating well. And if we could just fix that people ate healthy foods, they wouldn't get sick and I wouldn't have to treat them. So here we are, what, like 120 years later. Our club still meets on the second Monday of the month, which I think is when she started it back in 1899. It's just crazy. And it's really impressive. It sort of tugs at my heartstrings a little that, you know, people have been so passionate about it for so long.
Tonight, we're going to party like it's 1899.
Right. But yeah, so back to my chicken of the woods story, I really wanted to just connect with some people who knew more and build some confidence. And it turns out the Mycological Society was doing a foray not far from my house. And I just showed up and the people were so generous. And really a lot of the learning happens when you're in the woods in person with people. Of course, the last couple of years, we've been doing a lot of Zoom meetings, which has been amazing because we've gotten to talk to people from all over the country and all over the world. But really, it's that in-person touching, smelling, feeling, kind of getting your hands on something and seeing why is this different than this? What do you mean when you say the gills are attached? Or, you know, that whole taxonomy piece you were talking about. So we do a bit of Mushrooms 101, a lot of how does something grow? Why does it grow? When would you expect to see it? Is something like a decayer, is it a saprobe and you'd expect to see it growing on a pile of leaves or a pile of wood chips? Or is something like we talked about the chicken of the woods, is it a parasite? And is it infecting maybe a weakened host plant? Or there's that other category, the mycorrhizal mushrooms, which are these symbiotic ones that grow in association with a specific plant. And those are sort of like the chanterelles and the, you know, boletes and some of the other really good edibles.
American matsutake, maybe?
Matsutake, yeah. Even morels. Mm-hmm. And I know, you know, I'm not a scientist, and I'm can get myself in trouble by, you know, saying I know more than I do. But it's really kind of what you start to see in the woods. It's like, gosh, I only see these at this time of year, and I only see them with this mm-hmm. plant. And then you start to learn more about them and go, oh yeah, you know, these are the chanterelles that like oak trees. So if I want to find them, I probably should be in woods with oak trees, and start to learn about all the other plants in the woods as well. It just a lot like you were talking about with the hunters. You really have to have your eyes on and observe your surroundings, and it all starts to kind of come together. And it's just this crazy puzzle.
I've seen these sort of different pathways that people get into mycology from. So mm-hmm. obviously there's like the academic pathway. And then I see this amateur pathway that's sort of like kind of akin to bird watching, where it's, mm-hmm. it's like I need to find all these different mushrooms, not necessarily because of edibility or something like that. But then there's the people who get into it like you're described because they want to eat them. And then I meet the people who get into them because of the psychoactive mushrooms that kind of gets their, you know, piques their interest or whatever as well. So I see these like different ways that people come into it. What do you see in the Mycological Society? Like, who are the people who are coming into that, and what's attracting, I guess, the greater bulk of people?
I would say the majority is about edibility. Yeah. People are really, really interested. A lot of people tease. It's like what is this and can I eat it? Mm-hmm. And, you know, like you're on a hike and it's like, ooh, what about this? Can I eat it? What about this? Can I eat it? And I like to say lots of times, like I'll pick up a wood chip or a leaf or something. I'm like, a whole bunch of things you could eat, but it just doesn't mean it's going to be good. Like there's a whole bunch of things in the woods you could eat.
Yeah. Sometimes I look at the Guinness Book of World Records and it'll be like, okay, this guy ate an airplane, you know, little piece by piece, or this person ate a car. It's like, you can eat a lot of things that don't necessarily mean that they're nutritious or, you know, but they are edible. So that's one of the questions. And your book's like a proper field guide. So this is something I've been wanting to ask somebody who's worked on one for a long time. Is it seems to me that mycology is a kaleidoscope, and that it's always changing. The names and genuses get switched constantly. The specific epithets get changed a lot, and things are being renegotiated constantly in the taxonomy. But then there's also, in addition to that, you know, you'll typically have like a category called edibility in field guides, and you'll see things like choice or like edible, mm-hmm. or there's a lot that are, say, unknown, or, you know, that'll kind of reference that some people have eaten them. So I'm curious how you approach that. Obviously, you have ones like we've talked about, chicken in the woods, morels, maitakes, you know, matsutakes. Mm-hmm. We all know those are food. But then there's all these ones, the coral mushrooms are kind of an interesting example, where I've eaten some, I know people eat them, I know a lot of people that won't eat them, and it's like a questionable edibility. So how did you guys approach that in putting this book together?
You know, pretty carefully. In fact, there has been some feedback that, you know, we were a little too safe. At the same time we were working on the first edition of the book, Michael Kuo and Andrew Methevin were working on Mushrooms of the Midwest, which is a very different book than ours. It's got, you know, scientific it's names, it's got pictures of microscopic spores. It's very in-depth. So Michael Kuo is well known for mushroomexpert.com, and he's very opinionated about a lot of different mushrooms and the name changes, and he's on the forefront of a lot of that science. Our book really was trying to be a layperson's guide, right? Mm-hmm. And because people want to know what's edible, we tried to include that, but again, very carefully, just knowing that just because something's edible to me and I find it tasty doesn't mean it's going to agree with you. And if we heard any reports from any other, you know, sites or mycological societies of people getting sick from something, we wanted to include that. So people felt like maybe our book was a little safe, but I think people are just so interested in knowing that something is non-toxic and that they could possibly try it. I would also add that when I was talking about my brother being such a good morel hunter, He gets sick every time he eats morels. So he has stopped eating them. So, you know, we don't consider them a toxic mushroom, but that doesn't mean that they agree with everyone. And same with chicken of the woods. Some people can be very sensitive to certain mushrooms. So when we talk about something being edible, it's sort of in general, like lobsters are edible and some people have huge shellfish allergies and, you know, you sort of find out the hard way, right?
Mm-hmm. It's funny with chicken of the woods is the symptom that I've always heard is swelling of the lips. Is that?
Oh, I haven't heard that. That's awesome.
Oh, I hear that. Yeah, I hear that like people get swollen lips because when I look at that mushroom all shelved out, I think like that kind of looks like big old swollen lips, you know, but yeah, that's another thing that I find interesting. You were just saying there's non-toxic, which means you could eat it, but doesn't necessarily make it a choice edible. And then there's this thing of like poisonous, and you'll hear often in mushroom, in mycology, like deadly poisonous, which I think is like this important distinction for people to understand too, because there are things that you can eat that might be toxic. I've eaten a false morel once, you know, cooked in oil, like it's supposed to be very, very toxic. I had no ill effect. Now, I wouldn't repeat that or recommend it, but no ill effect. Or, you know, in the botanical world, like I've eaten just gallons of the seed kernels to choke cherries, which are supposed to, you know, be this, contain all the cyanide compounds. Well, I can speak from personal experience of doing this for decades. You can eat 2 gallons of those seeds and I can have no ill effect. But then you have these mushrooms that fall into the deadly poisonous category. And so I think that sometimes people don't make that distinction. They hear poisonous, they think die, and they don't realize poisonous in the mushroom world can often mean bellyache. How would you address that, I guess? I'll pass that back to you.
Yeah. I mean, as you start to learn about the different species, I think you're talking about the gyromitra, correct? The false morel.
Yeah, looks like somebody melted the top of it and it got all wonky and misshapen.
Well, and there's culturally people in, you know, like Finland and, you know, northern Russia and stuff have been eating those for years and, you know, processing them in a certain way to remove the toxins. And a lot of times they think it's more of the accumulation of those toxins in your body, you know, so it's like, how many can you eat and how many can I eat? And again, we'd only find out the hard way. Whereas when we talk about the kind of instantly deadly poisonous, and we're talking about the amanitas, like the death caps and the ones that have the amatoxins and other toxins that stay in our body. And actually by the time they get to your liver, you are probably going to need a liver transplant to make it through.
It's just terrifying. A liver transplant? That's
totally terrifying. And they even talk about accounts of people who have lived through eating that. And they'd say like, oh, it tasted really good.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like we were talking about, gosh, there's edible things that just don't taste good. I mean, you could eat them, but how do you make it taste good, right?
Right.
And then the things that may taste really good and you really shouldn't be eating them and should be safe. You know, just we kind of tell people in the club not to eat any of the Amanita species, even though I know there are
some
a few.
Edible. Yeah.
Yeah. Some are edible.
Yeah. It's so different in plant foraging because, nothing's obviously universal, but largely if something's poisonous, it tastes poisonous, you know, the alkaloids
the bitter.
Are bitter. Yeah. And so you've got a great system for detection of that. But the idea, you know, with mushrooms, it's like the idea that you wouldn't even know. And what I hear about like some of the destroying angel or death caps and stuff is that you kind of get sick and then you kind of get better. And then
I've heard that too.
And then you suddenly need a liver transplant. So it's just, I mean, the idea of being like, no, I'm coming out of it. I'm feeling better.
Right. You think you have some food poisoning, you know, you maybe are nauseous and then it gets better. And that's when you're truly in trouble.
Right. But I guess we're kind of going down the dark path here because there's so much goodness too. Tell me some of your favorite mushrooms to forage and what you like to do with them. We'll get back to the show in a moment, but first, this episode of the WildFed podcast is brought to you by Red Kill Mountain Homestead Farms. Red Kill Mountain is home to New York State's largest wild apple savanna. Overlooking the east branch of the Delaware River is a beautiful hillside covered in wild apples grown from seed. These apples aren't the name varieties of grafted clones you get in the store. These are wild, seed-grown apples. The apple season's just about over, but Red Kill Mountain Homestead Farms is shipping their wonderful dried apples, apple molasses, apple spread, and bourbon barrel maple syrup. I get really excited about their apple molasses, also known as cider syrup. Apple molasses was a traditional sweetener used in homestead kitchens before the availability of inexpensive sugar products, and today it's listed by the Slow Food Arc of Taste as an endangered food. Red Kill Mountain is one of only three producers left in the country. Red Kill's apple molasses is made by pressing fresh sweet cider from their hand-selected, genetically diverse apples, and then reducing it down into a syrup with the consistency of molasses. It's sweet, but with an incredible complex bouquet and flavor profile you won't find in other sweeteners. It's great for holiday dishes, baked goods, roasted vegetables, and is perfect for apple pies and crisps. You can even add a tablespoon to hot water for a quick hot cider drink. Head over to redkillmountain.com and use the coupon code WILDFED for 10% off your order. Red Kill Mountain Homestead Farms. Truly wild, truly diverse apples. Now, back to the show.
So I love finding hen of the woods. And we're talking about chicken of the woods. We're talking about hen of the woods. They're completely different species. And I suppose that's kind of the trouble of using common names is, you know, they start to kind of blend together. But I think, again, once you've had each of them in your hand or eaten them, you know which one you're talking about, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that's where people want to make sure that the naming is right. But as the scientific names change, I have found a lot of even super scientific people have reverted to the common names.
Yeah.
Especially to not get into arguments with other people about what the current name is. But yeah, so here in the Midwest, late in the fall, a lot of times we get hen of the woods or maitake, which is also a really commonly cultivated mushroom.
Is it but still gosh, Grifola frondosa? Is that
same? It is. Correct. Yep. Thank you for that. There's just something to me about it's just this nice woodsy, mushroomy flavor, but it's also just this really firm texture. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of people who are like, oh, I hate mushrooms. I think a lot of people hate mushrooms because they're used to these sort of squishy, slimy canned mushrooms or, you know.
Served up raw in a salad sometimes where you're like, it's so gross, yeah. Those button mushrooms, and you get them raw. You're like, take this back to the kitchen with this iceberg lettuce. What are you giving me?
Ugh, right? So I would love to challenge people who say I hate mushrooms to try chicken of the woods or hen of the woods or some of the wild species mm-hmm. and then kind of give them a second chance. But yeah, and I think for me, hen of the woods also, it's just so exciting to find a huge amount of them. Like you could find one mushroom that's just almost too big to carry home, and that's when you start to share it with your friends or, you know, dehydrate it or freeze it. A friend of mine who's a chef said whenever he would find a nice mushroom, he would cook a lot of it up to eat that at that time. And then he would also just cook a lot of it up in a lot of butter and then sort of freeze it in the butter, because now if you don't have a ton of mushroom with it, you've got this butter that's sort of coating it and preserving it. And it's the start of another, the start of another dish.
Yeah.
Or take, do a conserva where you're putting it in a ton of oil with herbs and stuff, and just don't bring it up to a sizzle, but just bring it up to temperature so it's slowly stewing in the oil. And then you add a little bit of acidic vinegar to it and preserve it in a jar. And then you've got these like pseudo, you know, oil and vinegar mushrooms that you could put into other dishes. And then use the oil and vinegar as a dressing or in something else. I know a lot of people pickle mushrooms and then cook with them. It's like there's this extra kind of flavor you get when you've already processed something, and it adds this depth to a dish.
Man, you're making me really hungry because, you know, there's snow on the ground out here right now. I'm not finding any mushrooms right now. I want to talk a little
like
more about
10 below here right
Is
now.
Is it? Okay,
it's
yeah.
So cold.
That's a cold part of the country, huh, where you are?
It's pretty cold, but it's funny. Lots of folks, our club used to go out and do a Chaga foray in January.
Oh,
we would
yeah.
go cross-country skiing looking for Chaga, and everyone would say, why do you do it in the winter? It's like, well, first, there's nothing else up to find. But second, there are no leaves on the trees, mm-hmm. and it's easier to spot. I think winter is a really great time to sort of go out and try to learn tree identification without the leaves.
From bark and from branchlet pattern. And
habit. Like yeah. It's like mm-hmm. there's always something to do outside, right?
Yeah. One of the things I love about foraging, and mushrooms help with this too, you know, you think you want to go just find the one thing, and then you realize you need to learn all these species that are in association with it. And then before you know it, mm-hmm. you've developed all these sort of friends out there, you know, wild creatures. And I want to stay on mycelia for a second because mm-hmm. It's like that. You know, if you want to get to know mycelia, you're going to get to know oak groves. And you're going to spend a lot of time in there. You're going to now know like, hey, it's a good acorn mast year. It's not, because you're going to see that, and you're going to bump deer, and you're going to bump turkeys, and you're going to start to encounter all of this other animals that are sort of in association with it, which I think is really cool. And earlier when I brought up the different pathways that I've seen people get into mushrooms, one that mm-hmm. I left out, which I think is becoming ever more prominent, is through the medicinal mushroom kind of path. And mycelia just does this double duty role, right? As an incredible edible, but it's also like one that's sort of in the cutting edge of the, where mycology and modern medicine are sort of overlapping, particularly around cancer treatment and things like that. So really fascinating in that regard too. I don't know if that's anything that you've looked at or interested in, but it's pretty incredible what they've been able to do, I guess, with chemotherapy, treatment and things like that.
Isn't it fascinating? I love it. I think this goes way back to even what we were talking about knowing where your food comes from and eating something that's sort of pure and from the land, but then kind of studying these really magical, you know, beings, right? Mm-hmm. And as a food source, it's like, I know turkey tail's been studied. Chaga is so popular now. It's like, so highly studied, and, you know, reishi, just so much. And there's all these different tinctures, and lots of people swear by them and just say, gosh, I don't feel right if I don't take my tincture. And I'm not a good do this every day person. You know, so I don't have habits like that, but I do love to find something, experiment with it, use it, eat it fresh, dehydrate it, and just incorporate it. I think sometimes when people are hard on things and saying, oh, this hasn't been properly studied. But it's like, but if you're eating well and you enjoy it and you're eating it instead of other things, right? Mm-hmm. I think that's a part of it too. It's like if you're not eating all these packaged processed foods because you've processed your own food and you've got some, you know, dehydrated, you know, nettles and mycelia and stuff to throw in a soup. It's like, I really get a rush out of that. I made a soup the other night and I'm just opening up jars of dehydrated things and sprinkling them in and remembering collecting them in the summer. And there's something about that as well. You know, the rush that you get from just sort of the memory of
where that food came from, right? It's like having that story. I often liken it to high-end wine, you know, and often say like you buy a high-end wine at a restaurant and it comes with quite a story. Usually somebody comes out to the table to tell you the story of that wine. And the more you know the story, the more you take time to appreciate the ingredient when you taste it. And it's like when you know the story of your mushrooms, like the meal's so different than if somebody just put it on a plate in front of you, because you're reminiscing through the process of eating it, you know.
I agree. It's we were so lucky to meet some local chefs in Minneapolis when we started getting into mushrooms, and every now and then we would so we got certified to, you know, to pick mushrooms and would, you know, bring them to the restaurant, and it happened to be a restaurant that would do a tasting menu. So they were, you know, lucky enough to just say, hey, we're going to do something with this tonight. A lot of times I think it's hard to really find enough to be on a menu, right? I know a lot of people are like, oh, I'm going to find all these mushrooms and I'm going to bring them to a chef. But a chef has to get them on their menu and know that they can serve them for many days. It's like changing a menu is a big deal, right? So lots of times they have to be cultivated or, you know, from a much larger, you know, foraging source than, you know, than just me and my husband for an afternoon right in the woods. But they would do just like, here's an amuse-bouche we're going to do and just let everyone in the restaurant try tonight because these guys popped in with some mushrooms. And they would actually say, well, you go tell those people where you found them and what it was like and stuff. So they sort of, they would treat us to a dinner of what they made from them and then let us kind of share the experience of finding them because they felt like that was sort of full circle for the meal. So, it was exciting.
Through this conversation, I'm thinking about, you talked about 1899 and this doctor, this physician, and how she had been noting that her patients weren't eating well. We're kind of like talking about the Industrial Revolution when it kind of went for the first time, people went from knowing almost all of their food, maybe they were buying sugar and flour, let's say, but they knew their food or they knew who was growing their food or harvesting their food. And then the Industrial Revolution happens and people get onto processed foods and canned foods and things start to centralize for the first time. And this is maybe like the first time in history you have a big population not knowing where their food comes from. And then we go through this like food desert in the United States through the, up until my early memories, the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s. Then we come to this amazing food renaissance. We're like in it right now.
Yeah.
But then we're also having another revolution. This is like a tech revolution. So the young generation now, I don't know that they're as keen, like, our generation's so keen on food, right? We're like really wanting to hear these stories and know about our food, and there's this big interest. These kids who are going into the metaverse, I don't know, like they might be like those people in 1899 who kind of lose track again and are eating 3D printed food if we don't get a hold of them, So this is like, it's a really interesting moment where you have the ability to really, there's like two paths that you can take, one where you really learn about your food and one where you don't. And it seems like I would imagine these mycological societies are filling up with people right now who are keen to reconnect with food at a time where connection with nature is like kind of getting tenuous, right? It's like you don't need to connect with nature right now if you don't want to.
Right. And I'm always torn because I love looking at people's photos on Instagram and following, their websites. And there's all this digital kind of eye candy out there. And because I'm a video producer, I appreciate that people have the skills to, create even like your podcasts and animations and, just other stuff for other people to consume. But I'm so bad at even posting a photo. It's like, it's to me, there's something about, being out in the woods and not having to have a phone with you, or you have it with you, but you sort of hope no one calls you or hope you don't have service. Right. And so it's like, I'm a bit torn because I really, really love that there's just so much out there and so much sharing. But I also want people to forget about it for a minute. I want them to truly be in the moment or, enjoy your food, and maybe you didn't even take a picture of it.
Right.
Oh, but it's like
there are very hungry algorithms out there that we need to feed constantly. I mean, we gotta educate the artificial intelligence here. This is a weird time because the degree to which, and I make a TV show about this stuff, so it's like it's nice in the sense that I have people following me around with the camera, so I don't have to wield the camera. That's kind of nice. But I know what you're saying. Like there's like an inverse relationship to how much I'm using my phone in nature and how much of the experience I'm taking in. I wrote a piece recently on my Instagram about a hunt that I blew because I was walking into the woods distracted from a phone call I just had. And it's like, I almost think we need to have some kind of, for people who go into nature, it's like we need to have some kind of digital hygiene ritual or something that like faster transition into the woods from our phones or whatever.
Yeah, but I completely appreciate looking into other people's worlds. Like right now, people on the West Coast are hunting mushrooms and posting pictures of these green lush places, and it's getting me through the winter. And in fact, actually, I was going to mention between doing the first edition of the book and the second edition of the book, we started using peeking at iNaturalist, and it was a way to see where are people finding things and what are the most common
Tell us about iNaturalist.
In that area. Yeah, so iNaturalist is, and I think there are many ways to use it, and I might not be completely representing it properly, but it's basically like a crowdsourced, almost like I see this, I post it. I could say as much as I know this is exactly a chicken of the woods. It's the Cincinnati variety. Like I might know a lot, or I might just say, I think this is a mushroom. And then other experts who are on iNaturalist can weigh in and say, oh yeah, that is a mushroom. It's, you know, it's actually this, or I think it's this. And sometimes people get into arguments about what the idea of something is. Mm-hmm. But it's sort of this crowdsourced way of defining what's out there and taking a snapshot of what people are seeing and, you know, basically identifying it by species name. And a lot of, there's a piece of iNaturalist you can sort by location, you can sort by, you know, genus or species or, but there's a bit of it that's like, I think it looks like this, you know, again, probably algorithms. But to me, I was like, oh, if I'm an intro mushroom hunter and I don't know what the genus is, because I think a lot of people try to explain mushrooms to you and they're like, well, here's the genus and species and here's how you know those. And it's almost like they're 10, 20 years in and forgot what it was like right. to first look at something. Mm-hmm. It's like, how do you get those fresh eyes on where you're like, what did, you know, what did that chicken of the woods look like to me the first time I looked at it? And, you know, why was I not sure what it was? So that piece of iNaturalist, I really liked seeing what, you know, you can kind of see what people thought they were seeing and you can see through a bunch of different eyes, right? And kind of compare and you can see pictures of the same species from all different locations and all different conditions, right? Because in a field guide, it's sort of this beautiful picture of the perfect mushroom. Well, what if the one you find in the woods looks completely different?
Which it often does. It often does. Way more than with plants. Way more.
Right. Almost always does, right? It's like it never looks like the picture in the book. You know, unless you're lucky and you found like, oh, here's a young one growing next to an old one, next to a perfect one. And, you know. But
even
in general,
using our example of maitakes, it's like sometimes I find them, they're almost purple. Sometimes they're dusky tans and browns. Sometimes they're gray. I found them in the crevices of trees where they're almost albino.
White,
and so,
yeah.
So it's like, you know, the picture is, you know, big fronds. I've seen little fronds. So, you know, you have to pick one or two for your book. And then, you know, it's kind of
right.
hard to ID from a picture.
It's impossible to ID from a picture. I think, you know, that's the upside and downside of a little field guide, right? You want it small enough to carry in your pocket, mm-hmm. but then how, you know, like how many pictures do you get to include and how many even species do you get to include? It's like there's 5 or 10,000 species in the area you're in yeah. and your book has 300.
Mm-hmm.
what are the chances?
When you said you used iNaturalist, or it impacted the second edition, how did it impact what you guys did?
For me, it was like, if we were going to recommend, like, okay, here's a species we included in the last book. What else could we say it looks like? Or what do people think it might look like, you know, as you're sort of cross-referencing? Or is there a related species that we didn't include in the first book that we might just want to mention in the second book? I think, think about the russulas, or some people call them russulas. There's so many, you know, say you picture three of them in a book. What other ones do you want to mention so someone can go back and say, look at Michael Kuo's book or, you know, some other much larger book, or even go back online and on Mushroom Expert and say, like, what else might this look like? But now I at least know where to start, right? I'm going to say that based on the features that they described on this russula, I'm going to say this could be a russula, right? And then get the list of the other 30 that you're like, oh, you know. And again, that's when people start to kind of get overwhelmed or give up. because it's like, I'll never know. There's just too many. And I would encourage people to just say, you don't have to know them all and you will never know them all. And you can have so much fun knowing 10 mushrooms and being in the woods and learning more. So yeah, I would encourage people to just not be overwhelmed and realize that we're all overwhelmed and that's kind of the fun of it.
And some people are really attracted. I think some of the people I know who are the full on, you know, mushroom, just the people who are like deep into mycology, they sort of love that about it, because it's, you know, you've got to be tolerant to rules that are constantly changing. You know, that's it's a very unique science. It's very unique field, I should say, where it's in such chaos all the time. I mean, I can't really think of, you know, maybe genomics is like that or something, but it's like always new stuff constantly.
Totally. And it's like, it's going to change again, right? Right. It's like, what if the way we're testing DNA right now isn't the full story? And what if it all changes again? And it's like, to be excited about that. I know my mentor in the club, actually Ron Spinoza, has been in the Mycological Society forever. And he's been my mentor. And I know at first he was a little bummed that the names are changing. He's like, I'm 70. I just learned all the names. Now I have to relearn them.
Yeah. Oh, for the people whose name is now changing, you know, like I named it and now it's being reclassified. That's gotta be hard.
It's got to be. But it's the interesting thing to me is, though, it's like when you look at pictures of mushrooms, who's to say that any of them are what we thought they were, right? I don't know. I think I'm not a great taxonomist and namer. And I know as humans, our instinct is to, if we name something, we know it, right? It's sort of like you can kind of claim that you know something or claim that knowledge by putting a name to it. And
it's powerful in our psyche.
It really is.
Right in the book of Genesis, right? It's like, you guys, now your job's go name everything. It's like kind of one of the oldest written documents in the, you know, history of mankind says that about us, you know.
Have you read Michael Pollan's Omnivore's Dilemma?
I have, yeah.
But yeah, and he talks about like this perfect meal he had. And I remember there was a section where he talks about learning a chanterelle and holding it. And to me, it's like, it's hard to put into words. But basically he's saying, until you've had something in your hand and felt it and smelled it and know it. And, you know, how many species of chanterelle are there? You know, 20, 30, depends on where you are in the world, right? But he knew it was a chanterelle, and he learned it from someone he was with, and he knew they were going to eat it. And then he had that, you know, experience of eating it afterwards. And it was sort of like, I will know this forever now. So even if that name changes,
right?
Like, he knows that being, right? Or that object.
It's like if a friend of yours got married, changed their last name. It's like, yeah, okay, but I still know you. So,
yeah. Oh, that's a good comparison. Yeah, I like that.
Well, it is interesting to imagine. I think a lot about, because I got into wild foods kind of, you know, in the second half of my life. And so grew up, you know, like a lot of kids in the 80s and 90s, I just didn't really have a connection to food. And then when I started to care about what I ate, it was from like a supermarket perspective. So everything that I got came in already its individual body parts, not like whole. And then slowly, like, I worked my way back to the creatures themselves, whatever kingdom of life they came from. And now I just think a lot about how somebody might, you know, every time they go to a seafood restaurant, they order halibut, but they don't know what halibut looks like, or they order haddock, they've never seen it, you know, or 100 other foods. I often will quip about like a lettuce plant when you see it go to seed. And you look at it and just have no idea if you didn't know that that's
what it was.
That's lettuce, right? So right, it's so strange, the idea that we build our bodies out of other creatures and then we don't even know those creatures. It's like, how did we get to this place where we could be that removed? It's like that high up on the Maslow hierarchy of needs that you lose touch with actually what's at the base.
Yeah, or even like renaming something because it's sounds better, right? Like when you're talking about fish, it's like there's all these sort of like the way it's processed. Or Right. It's like, what does that mean? What is this? Ocean or what perched. Am I eating? Right. Yeah. It's like, because, well, no one's going to eat it if it's called, right, you know, right, whatever.
Chilean sea bass. That's what some of these names are like, wait, what? Yeah, it's really funny.
We were talking about that with some of the mushrooms, too. Actually, I think Gary Linkoff is known for just like, oh, you can give it whatever common name you want, right? Do you know that there's a few different mushrooms that parasitize other mushrooms and change mm-hmm. their shape, which like the lobster is crazy. Yeah, mm-hmm. like lobster. And yeah, crazy fascinating to me, too, that it's like when you think about something being attacked by something else before it sort of forms and changes its species. It's like, just yeah. think about that for a moment. Yeah. I'm just like, oh, my cat caught a cold and turned into a dog.
Yeah, it's like, you know, that's like an alien sci-fi movie, right? Like, you become another species. How does right? that work? Body snatcher.
So we had, have you heard of the aborted Antiloma mushroom?
I don't think so.
So it's this crazy, I think first they thought that it was like this Antiloma had been attacked by a parasite and it gets this aborted form, a lot like a lobster does, where like the gills don't show, it can't reproduce sexually with its spores. So I suppose it's a way of one mushroom making sure another one doesn't, you know, reproduce in an area. But it's got some kind of a complicated life cycle with our malaria honey mushrooms. So it's probably more like an Antiloma parasitizing a honey mushroom. But it comes up in this crazy, they call it an aborted form. And it looks like a...
It's all cauliflowered? Is that... I'm looking at pictures right now.
Yeah, it's... I mean... I don't even know what you call this. Just all lumpy and, you know. Right. But if you were going to sell some of them to a chef or say, hey, yeah, we're going to cook these aborted Antilomas.
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
no ew. One wants the word aborted on their menu or whatever. So even like our club was calling them like shrimp of the woods or right. stump dumplings. Or,
stump dumplings. I
mean? It's like, what does that mean?
But, yeah, that's good. Yeah, exactly. Marshmallow clouds.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, even Antiloma sounds like a type of cancer. It's not real.
Exactly. It all sounds bad. It's like, yeah. Okay, we want to eat these, so how do we make them sound good? How do we give them a name that is appetizing? Because we can't eat anything that doesn't sound good.
Yeah, it's funny. You were talking about Chaga before, and it's like I've seen some of the names clinker, polypore, like different, you know, different names that have canker in there. But you say Chaga, there's something about that name. It's like you've probably watched it. You've been into mushrooms, you said, about 15 years. I've had a product on the market for about 15 years. Which is a dual extract of chaga, and watching how people respond to that mushroom, it's so strange to me because it's not really edible. It's not that useful except in a tea, but man, do people get just hot for it, huh? It's like really interesting to watch.
Yeah.
I wanted to tell you a little anecdote that maybe you can test this out. You know, so the extract we make is dual extracted. So there's a hot water component and an alcohol component, and then those get recombined. So I'm not sure what, you know, just to get it, make sure it's full spectrum, but I'm not sure what fraction I'm getting this anecdote about, but we've had three customers write us now and say that it has restored their smell and taste after having COVID. And we just keep
really
getting, well, we you know, it's an anecdote, wow. right? Like I have no idea.
Oh yeah, yeah. But
I just keep getting this feedback from people, and then one of our staff as well experienced it. So you know, that's the fourth anecdote now. So I don't know if it'd be the water side of it. I don't know if it's the alcohol side of it, but it's just neat to watch when a species comes into the public awareness, because I've watched this thing go from unknown to, you know, $65 a pound dry, like so fast.
So fast. And I think that the anecdotes and the, you know, the anecdotal evidence, like that's where you start.
Yeah.
It's like, that's where you're like, oh, if this is happening, what could be tested? Right. It's like you kind of, it's the reason to look more into it, which I think is fascinating. I love that.
You have your career is, I think, is in video, right? And I was reading your bio and it mentioned macro photography. And I just wanted to like see, you know, where that's intersecting with the interest in mycology, because it seems like those overlap nicely.
Yeah, you know, for when we were working on the book, and you know, there's so many books out there with beautiful, beautiful mushroom photography, and we had some pretty strict rules about what we wanted for the book. It's like, you know, we couldn't do any soft focus. We had to make sure that the plants and stuff in the background were in focus. Like we really wanted it to be more scientific. So while I'm really proud of a lot of the photos in the book, they're not these sort of frame them, put them on the wall, you know, magical, you know,
not art.
Art photos. Yeah. But I did get a macro lens when we were working on the book, and it's just crazy how your view of things changes when you're that close to something, right? In fact, I even found that after I had spent too much time, I would say I've been in my camera too long, I would get lost in the woods so quickly. And a lot of times my husband would be ahead of me and he's like, oh, you're taking so long. You're just down looking at the same mushroom for like 20 minutes. Just take the picture and move on. And I was just like, I just can't. I'm just in there. I'm in this crazy macro world, like seeing things and seeing the mosses around things and all the different parts, right?
Like another realm.
It's totally like another realm. You know how people have those flags that they put in their yard when they're training their dog to wear like an electric fences or, you know, we had some of those and he would be so far ahead of me in the woods. He would put them next to things. He's like, I think you should stop here and look.
Oh, no kidding.
Because I almost, he's like, I can't wait for you. And you seem to be way far behind. And I had a hard time like seeing the wide picture. Yeah. I was just like, okay, which way am I going? Where did he go? What should I look at next? Because I was sort of like had been transported into this super macro close-up world. I almost
the forest and the trees.
Exactly. I'm like, oh, I'm so deep in my camera. Yeah. I don't know if I can get to the next location.
But this is one of those worlds. Mushrooms really have this, like the more you zoom in, the more interesting things start becoming. You must have saw Fantastic Fungi on Netflix.
Yes.
That videography that he does, that like what do you call that, time lapse that he's doing? Goodness, it's
incredible. Isn't that boggling?
Yeah.
I'm like, just think of the patience to capture that. It's really fascinating. Our club hosted a screening of that when it first came out at a really, you know, neat local kind of art house theater. They even did a mushroom themed cocktail for us.
Oh yeah, what was it? I'm curious.
It was called the Foragers Old Fashioned. I brought them some local maple syrup and some bitters that I made from black walnuts, and then we brought dehydrated black trumpets that they soaked the bourbon in. So I totally recommend it. The film, first they're like, okay, well, we'll play this mushroom film if you think it's going to be popular. And I was like, well, you know, we have enough club members that I think at least one showing, you know, will sell out. And 5 sold out showings later, the people who own the theater were like, what is going on with this mushroom film?
Really?
Yeah, it was just an event. It was unheard of. It was like, as soon as they announced another showing, it would sell out.
We had Eugenia Bone on the show recently, who's featured in the film, and she's friends with the videographer and producer of the film, and she was saying that all of that time lapse is done in very controlled settings. You know, he has to do that indoors and everything, which I didn't realize watching it, but it made so much sense to me after. Totally. That film ends up having a really strong psychoactive mushroom component. Is that something you care to comment on, or you prefer to leave that side of the house to other folks?
No, well, I mean, I don't want to not comment on it because I mean, it's a thing, right? It's part of this world of mushrooms. Yeah, it's like traditionally the mycological societies have shied away from that because I think, you know, for a while, you know, you'll do a presentation on mushrooms and a lot of people are like, what about the magic mushrooms? What about the magic mushrooms? It's like when it's the first question that comes out of everyone's mouth. It's like, I'm just here to find the magic mushrooms.
Right,
it's like,
right.
Oh, come on.
You can spot that dude as soon as he walks in the room usually.
Right. So it's like they have really traditionally shied away from talking about it. But I think with the help from that movie and a lot of the other studies that are going on, it's coming back into the forefront and being okay to talk about, which I think is great, because it's, I don't know, anytime you're kind of shoving something down or not sharing the information, it's like there's a lot more misinformation that will come out. So to me, it's like, I think it's great that it's being talked about. And I when I watch the film and even other related films, there's I'm mostly just sad that it was crushed for so long, right? Like, think of all the inroads they were making and all this help that people could have gotten for addiction and PTSD and stuff that we didn't get to do for, what, like 30, 40 years, because we were just afraid.
I mean, during the rise of the pharmaceutical mood-altering drugs, you know? But it's also really powerful, you know, Paul Stamets being such an pivotal player in the, you know, where we're at with mushrooms today, and hearing his story in the film of it curing his stuttering and sort of being how he got to where he is today. It's just, it's just a really remarkable piece of it. And like you mentioned, there being some, you know, some really legitimate science being done now into, you know, things like PTSD. I mean, it's just so, so potent to know that that's, and non-toxic, that that's like a road that people can take. So it'd be interesting to see where we're at. I saw this magnet the other day, and it said, it's like a couple whispering to each other, like 1950s pinup couple. And it says, something like, who'd have thought we'd be smoking weed together as a family at a family gathering, and it would be the family gathering part that would be illegal. You know,
and
that's very funny to me. But like, you know, it's interesting where we see cannabis today, because I'm curious if we'll see, you know, these psilocybin mushrooms be following on the coattails, becoming socially acceptable, and then maybe working their way into the, because, you know, like where I want to take this too is not to just get stuck on this psychoactives, but there's these roles for mushrooms to play in the future. Part of it is in medicine. Part of it is in, you know, psychology. Part of it is in landscape regeneration and, you know, reclamation of industrial pollution. It's like all of these places where it seems like we haven't even really begun to see what allies they're going to be for us into the future, right? Folks like yourself are just like sort of opening the door for society to hopefully start to step through, because it seems like there's a, you know, I don't mean to be utopian here because I'm not, but it's like there's some really powerful stuff that these organisms could be doing if we see them as allies, huh?
Totally powerful. And I was in actually the Sonoma County Mycological Association every year does an event called Soma Camp, which is actually it would have been held in a couple weeks. And it's like, for someone like me who is in the deep freeze here in Minnesota, why wouldn't you want to go to, you know, Sonoma County and look for mushrooms in January, right? Yeah. But in California, I met a few people when I was out there at that event that were at the kind of like legalized psilocybin movement. But it wasn't even just the legalizing psilocybin mushrooms. It was like legalizing nature.
Yes.
Right. So it's like if something grows in the woods and it has powerful components and can be used, of course we want to be careful. But for the government to be so afraid of it, to call it illegal, to me just feels wrong. It's like I should be able to go pick a plant or a mushroom or something that's growing, especially if I know how to grow it. It shouldn't be, you know, illegal.
Especially when a 10-year-old can go to the hardware store and buy a gallon of Roundup Ready. You know,
there you
mean?
Go, right?
It's like, doesn't really make
sense. Yeah, it's like we can buy all these poisons, but nature is illegal because we might not know what to do with it. It's like, well, then let's learn. Let's all, you know, try to not be so afraid of everything before we know about it. Or,
But our culture's been afraid of mushrooms for so long, and not just the kinds that we were just talking about, but in general. I mean, I feel like there's this renaissance right now in mushroom edibility, wild mushroom edibility. But as a kid, it was like button mushrooms. And then I remember when we started to see portobellas, and that was like, oh my gosh, like there's another kind of mushroom that you can eat, you know? And now, you know, to go into like Whole Foods produce section and you're like, oh, lion's mane and maitake and shiitake and, you know, 16 other ones. And it seems like while you always hear stuff about, you know, in China, in Russia, in Japan, where mm-hmm. other cultures have embraced, you know, the fungal world a long time ago, but it's like we are just starting to get comfortable with that, huh?
Totally. I had a friend and other mentor in the Mycological Society who grew up in Poland, and we would go out on hunts, and he would pick things that for the table and for eating that I would have never picked. And actually the russulas were one of them. He identified them by taste in the woods.
Wow.
Just because that's how he learned as a kid. Yeah. So he would pick something, take a little nibble. And if it had a certain taste, he knew it was a keeper. And if it didn't, he would throw it back. And, you know, always something that we didn't want to recommend to the beginning hunters in the club. It's like, oh, just taste it. Right. You know, first off, we wouldn't tell people to eat mushrooms raw. When you were talking about having button mushrooms on your salad as a kid, mm-hmm. they say, I don't even think that those are digestible by your body. It's basically like eating a wood chip. It's mm-hmm. like you can eat it and it will pass through, but you're really not getting any nutrition from it. So, but yeah, he would just take the tiniest nibble and then spit it out and would know by the taste on his tongue whether it was an edible or not. And it's, that's quite the skill, right? And it's something, hard to put in a book or pass on to someone else. It's really something you'd have to experience with someone in the woods and have them explain, you know, how they learned. And it's, yeah.
The history is so cool. Like I love, are you familiar with Otzi, the Iceman from the
yes.
Alps, you know,
yes.
He's got like two species of mushrooms, like strung out on necklace, like beads that he's carrying with
yes.
him, you know, in that kit that's preserved and, you know, or seeing some of those old, like, that felt that would be made from, is it foam?
Yeah, the amadou. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Fomatopsis.
Yeah, it's just like, you know, and just thinking about the idea that you could be cleaning up heavy metals from a, you know, a toxic site or, you know, converting hydrocarbons, you know, back to fungal flesh or whatever. It just seems like, that we got to get past these fears, like, because even when we talk about, like you were saying before, about tasting a mushroom, it's kind of like, oh my gosh, like we're so afraid of him that it's like, whoa, wait, what are you doing? You know, it's like he's playing with snakes or something, you know. but you look at these cultures who have maturity around mushrooms just because they have embraced them a long time ago, and they just don't have as much, you know. It's like I remember traveling in Southeast Asia and going to the zoo one time and being like, whoa, there's only a 3-foot wall for that saltwater croc. Like I could climb in there. And it's like, well, yeah, you can climb. Go ahead if you want. But like,
but you shouldn't.
Here it'd be like a 15-foot wall with, like, you know, outward facing electrified barbed wire, like everything's padded for our safety. And I know, like, for you doing this book, it's like you said, erring on the side of caution, like this is such a litigious society, like you have to, but you know, that's the smart thing to do, but it does.
But isn't it sad?
Yeah, kind of. Right? Kind of.
Yeah. I love hearing your story from Southeast Asia. I have a friend who was traveling there as well and said he rented a motorcycle. And he was like, what do I have to sign? What do I have to prove for insurance? What about this? And they were just like,
nothing.
If you break it, you have to pay for it. Your government isn't here to protect you right now. Right. You have to actually, like, be responsible for yourself. Your friends, yeah. You know, it's like, sorry, this is just how it works. It's, you know, practical. Don't break it. Don't go hurt your, don't jump in with a crocodile.
Yeah, exactly.
It's probably not a good idea.
That's kind of the whole thing with mushrooms. I think it's kind of a fun way to sum it up, because it just seems like, you know, proceed at your own risk and take self-responsibility, and, you know, it will weed out, because you've heard that saying, like, there's old mushroom pickers and there's bold mushroom pickers, but there's no old bold mushroom pickers. It's kind of
right.
It's sort of like that, right? It's like, hey, proceed at your own risk. I like
some of the folks in our club like to say, you can eat any mushroom once.
Yeah, exactly.
But no, it's, I think, like you said, being respectful of it, mm-hmm. And cautious and respectful. It's like, it doesn't mean you have to be so afraid, but, you know, don't go gorge on a whole bunch of morels that you've never had before. First off, you'll probably get sick from eating too many of them anyway, but, you know, taste it. Or maybe you don't even need a ton of everything, right? I remember I was actually recently got to meet Sam Thayer, and I got his books, and there's something in the intro that was talking about just this taste that you dream about, this kind of hidden flavor that you didn't know existed. And I loved that, because it's like, it doesn't have to be like, oh, I always have to find enough mushrooms to fill the whole table. It's like, maybe you only find 4 or 5 chanterelles, and maybe you have a nice omelet with them mm-hmm. prominently placed on the top and really enjoy them. Or maybe you find a ton of them, so you pickle them so you can, you know, enjoy them all year round. But it's, I think there's a respect for nature and for what you're finding, and a respect for other people. And it's like, yeah, you don't have to go crazy. You can learn at your pace, you know?
Well said. And I guess in conclusion, what's like kind of final thoughts for people, especially like people who are wanting to go deeper or maybe new to it altogether? Like, where do you send people? What do you recommend? Like, your book, Mushrooms of the Upper Midwest, I mean, it sounds like to me that it sounds so specific, like the upper Midwest, not just the Midwest, the upper Midwest, so specific. But realistically, even out here in Maine, I'm going to probably half of these species are here, right? So like, how do you recommend people like find out where they are?
You know, I would recommend join a mycological society. A lot of them, you can attend their meetings even without being a member. I mean, unfortunately, a lot of them are on Zoom now, but that means you could join a lot of different clubs and, you know, listen to different speakers from around the country. A lot of them host events like annual forays or, you know, regional forays in different parts of the country, and get to meet some of the people in your area. I think being out in the woods with a few people who are a bit more experienced is how you learn. And when I first started, I thought every time I go out, I'm going to try to learn one new mushroom. You know, it's like, it's tempting to think, oh, I'm just going to dive in and learn all of this right now. And, but it's something that you can keep doing for years and years and years. You don't have to learn it all right now. Enjoy it as it presents itself to you, and as you're enjoying it, you know, like, I would say that, I was going to say that our book was called Mushrooms of the Upper Midwest because Michael Kuo's book came out the exact same year, and it was called Mushrooms of the Midwest.
Yeah, right.
Right. But Teresa did work with two other mycologists. She did a Northeastern version and a Mushrooms of the Northwest version. She's done wild fruits and berries of all different regions. And then there's so many other books. It feels like even in this digital age where there's a ton of stuff available online, mushroom people really like their books. Like mm-hmm. even when we'd be out on a foray, at the end of the foray, we're spreading everything out on the table to look at it, and people just bring out their books
yeah,
and cross-reference.
Right.
And so, and maybe that's because things are changing, but yeah, even the old books where the names are wrong, I still keep those around and mm-hmm. love to look at them.
Yeah.
And learn from the old timers for sure, which I'm quickly becoming one of the old timers somehow. Oh,
not yet. well, it's been it has been really fun to talk to you today. Do you have anywhere you like to send anybody, if social media you want to promote, or where you like people to get the book or anything like that?
You know, the The book's publisher is Adventure Keen, and they've got a lot of outdoor books. I do like to send people to the North American Mycological Association website. It has a list of other local mycological societies around the whole country. And every year they host a foray in a different part of the country. So a different club will say, we want to show our, you know, show everyone around our neck of the woods now. So every year it's kind of at a different time of the year and a different location. And I have learned so much just by traveling to those locations and letting people say, you know, here's the kind of trees we have here and here's the kind of mushrooms we have here. And, you know, our mushroom season is January or our mushroom season is, you know, November, you know. So I think it just starts to give you the whole picture.
That's awesome. Thank you so much for your time today and your contribution with this book. And yeah, it's just been a blast chatting with you.
Thank you so much. You're such a generous interviewer, and I love listening to your podcast. I'm a newbie to podcasts, but I've completely enjoyed them. So thank you so much.
Thanks for listening to the WildFed podcast. Help us grow this show by subscribing and leaving us a rating and review. It ensures better rankings and more advertiser interest, which translates directly into better shows, more awesome guests, and a constant stream of fresh new content. Have a question you'd like answered on the show, or a hunting, fishing, or foraging trip you'd like to host us on? Email us at info@wild-fed.com. If you still haven't seen season one of the WildFed TV show, you can go to myoutdoortv.com, grab yourself a free trial subscription, and then check out all 10 episodes. Season two of WildFed premieres on Outdoor Channel in early 2022. And be sure to visit our website, wild-fed.com, to check out our store for WildFed hats, stickers, and more. WildFed. Food is all around you.